हेलो
हेलो, आ गया।
बोलोगे
गुड मॉर्निंग एवरीवन। टुडे माय टॉपिक फॉर सेमिनार इज माइकोप्लाज्मा जेनिटालिया द नेक्स्ट इमर्जिंग सुपरबग। माय मॉडरेटर इज डॉक्टर विनू मैम। आई एम द प्रेजेंटर। दिस इज द लेआउट ऑफ माय प्रेजेंटेशन। फर्स्ट इज द इंट्रोडक्शन टू द माइकोप्लाज्मा। द माइकोप्लाज्मा आर द स्मॉलेस्ट फ्री लिविंग सेल्फ रेप्लिकेटिंग माइक्रो। सो दे डजंट हैव सेल वॉल। Instead of cell wall, they contain cellular membrane, that is three-layered cellular membrane that is made of cholesterol. Because of this absence of cell wall, they are not sensitive to any cell wall acting agents, especially beta-lactam. And also, their shape is not maintained, so they are pleomorphic and they won't stain with Gram stains. And they are reproduced by binary fission or budding. They doesn't have flagella and they are non-sporing. But some species of mycoplasma, they are showing gliding motility, especially mycoplasma pneumoniae, mycoplasma genitalium and mycoplasma mobile. This gliding motility is mainly by presence of the specialized tip structure. This picture shows the structure of mycoplasma. Here there is no cell wall and it contains trilaminar cellular membrane and DNA and RNA. Coming to the taxonomy and classification, it belongs to class molecules. Molecules means soft skin. And order Mycoplasmatales and family Mycoplasmataceae. So this Mycoplasmataceae family contains two genus. One is Mycoplasma, another one is Ureoplasma. In Mycoplasma, these are the Mycoplasma species and Ureoplasma species. So first identified is Mycoplasma hominis and followed by Mycoplasma fermentans. So this Mycoplasma genitalium, which is discovered at 1981. So this all the Mycoplasma, some are pathogenic and some are common cells of our body. So pathogenic are Mycoplasma hominis, that mainly associated with genital tract disease, and Mycoplasma fermentans, that also associated with genital tract disease, and Ureoplasma ureolyticum and Mycoplasma genitalium, that these two are also genital mycoplasmas. And some other less common mycoplasmas like Mycoplasma pyrum, spermatophyllum and penetrans and amphoriformae, they are doubtful pathogenicity. And this Mycoplasma pyrum, which is commonly associated with the contamination of cell cultures. And Mycoplasma pneumonia is a main pathogenic organism that is associated with respiratory tract diseases. And other common cell mycoplasmas are Mycoplasma salivarium, primatum, oral, buccal, fascium and lipophyllum. These are all common cells of oropharynx and nasopharynx. And these mycoplasmas can be differentiated by metabolizing the glucose and arginine. So this mainly pathogenic Mycoplasma hominis, that will ferment arginine. And Mycoplasma fermentans, it will ferment both glucose and arginine. And Mycoplasma pneumoniae and Mycoplasma genitalium, it will ferment the glucose. Next, what is the difference between mycoplasmas and L forms? So Mycoplasma doesn't contain cell wall, but here in Mycoplasma it is permanently cell wall is absent. But in L forms, because of some stressful response like antibiotic exposure, it will lose its cell wall and become L forms. In L forms, there are two L forms. One is unstable L forms and stable L forms. So in unstable L form, there is a chance of revert back to normal when the stress is removed, that is antibiotic exposure. But in stable L form, the cell wall will become permanently absent, and but stable L form and Mycoplasma can be differentiated by the biochemical and antigenicity and biochemical properties of stable L form will be similar to the parent bacteria. And other differences are, there is no precursors of peptidoglycans will be seen in Mycoplasma, but there are remnants of cell wall will be present in L forms. and cell membrane that is made of sterol, which is present in mycoplasma, and the sterol will be absent in elfo. And mycoplasmas are usually filterable, but elfoams are not filterable. And mycoplasma can cause the disease, but this elfoams, they cannot cause the disease, but they are important for persistence of the certain infections, and it leads to chronic infections. So these are the some points to differentiate mycoplasma, which is from the viruses. So first, the features which are resembling of viruses are the size is very less, that is ranging from 150 to 350 nanometer, and as like viruses, they are filterable by bacterial filters. But the features which are different from viruses are they are free living, but viruses are cell associated, and these mycoplasmas can grow on the artificial cell-free culture media. At the same time, they are sensitive to antibacterial agents except cell wall acting agents. These are the list of bacteria which shows the L forms. These are the common bacteria which are showing the L form. Staphylococcus aureus, Streptococcus pyogenes, Streptococcus viridans, and all other bacteria which are showing the L form. And coming to the topic proper, Mycoplasma genitalium. So Mycoplasma genitalium is the emerging causative agent of sexually transmitted infection in both sexes. So this is a typical morphology of Mycoplasma genitalium, which is a flask shaped with prominent truncated terminal portion. So the size is very less, which is 0.6 to 0.7 micrometer in length, and width is 0.3 to 0.4 micrometer at the tip with the bra, which is 0.06 to 0.07 micrometer. So how the Mycoplasma genitalium was discovered? So it was discovered in 1980 from the two men who suffered from non-gonococcal urethritis. So it was first isolated from the St. Mary's Hospital at London, United Kingdom. So the samples were collected. The samples are urethral swabs from the 13 men, which are transported by the sucrose phosphate transport medium, and that medium had been inoculated at 37 degrees Celsius per month, and after the month, after the 50 days, that there are two strains which are G37 and M30, which are glucose fermenting mycoplasmas, were identified. But these both strains are closely related to other mycoplasmas, but they are different serologically from other mycoplasmas. Coming to the genome of mycoplasma, the genome is very minimal. The size is ranging from 577 to 590 kilobases. So here we can see the mycoplasma genitalium, the genome size is at 600, but as compared to Staphylococcus aureus, which is 2700, and Escherichia coli, which is around 4700, and the largest will be the Mesorhizopodium lotei, which is around 7000 kilobase pairs. So this is the smallest genome, and the GC content is 32%. And this what is the speciality in this genome is this genetic code, usually the UGA. In other species, which is encode first, which is the stop coder, but this UGA, which is in Mycoplasma genitalium, it encodes the tryptophan. And also this Mycoplasma genitalium, which is actually evolved from Clostridium like gram-positive organism by genomic reduction, while that genomic reduction process, which reduced that it lost all the genes which are necessary for the metabolic process, like synthesis of nucleic acids and lipid and protein metabolism. So it entirely depends on the host, or it in culture media it needs precursors of nucleic acid and lipids, and at the same time it doesn't have any plasmids and extra chromosomal DNA. So coming to the tip organelle, which is the specialized structure which is present in Mycoplasma genitalium. So this tip organelle, which is important for the Mycoplasma genitalium for various functions. First one is the motility, next is cell division, and main function is for adherence, and followed by virulence. So here we can see the bacterial flagella structure, and this is the tip organelle structure. Here in bacterial flagella, it contains three parts. One is a basal body, another one is a hook, another one is a filament. But here it contains wheel structure, wheel complex, rod structure. Next is the terminal button. So these three structures are important for these four functions. So here in terminal button, we can see this P110 and P140 proteins and P32 proteins. And this wheel complex, we can see Mycoplasma genitalium 491, 219, 200 and 386 proteins. So these three structures have different functions. Coming to the pathogenesis, so this Mycoplasma genitalium will attach us to the different type of cells, mainly in the epithelial cells of genital tract, next fallopian tube cells, spermatozoa, and it also attaches to the RBCs. So the receptor for attachment is sialic acid. So once after attachment, it will go intracellularly, and after that it stimulates various cytokines to produce, and that cytokine which causes the various inflammatory response. At the same time, it also stimulates the production of hydrogen peroxide and superoxide free radicals, so that will damage the tissues. And also it has several mechanisms for evade the host immune response, so thereby it will be persistent in the human body. So I will explain the mechanism of persistent later. So what are the virulence factors for Mycoplasma genitalium? First is the adhesion. Adhesion is the important mechanism for initiation of any infection or colonization, followed by intracellular localization and various enzyme and genetic variations. I will explain each. So first is the adhesion to the epithelial cells, mainly genital epithelial cells. So this process of adhesion is important for colonization and initiation of any infections. So unitract is the primary tissue which is infected by this Mycoplasma genitalium. So this adhesion molecules, mainly this P, I already explained the terminal button structures are P140, P10 and P32. P32 and P65. These four structures are present in the terminal button. These four are responsible for addition to the epithelial cells, but major additions are P140 and P110. This P140, which is encoded by gene called MG191, also called MGPB, and P110, which is encoded by Mycoplasma genitalium PCG. So next is the intracellular localization. So it behaves like a facultative anaerobic facultative intracellular pathogen. So exact mechanism for intracellular process is not known, but this intracellular localization, which so because of this intracellular localization, it avoids the antibody mediated immunity and also avoids some antibiotics which are acting on the Mycoplasma genitalium. So this is also one of the process for persistence of Mycoplasma genitalium infection. So other than this Mycoplasma genitalium, other mycoplasmas like penetrans, Mycoplasma fermentans, Mycoplasma hominis and Mycoplasma pneumoniae, these all also intracellular mycoplasmas. Next, coming to the gliding motility. So this gliding motility, which also by tip structure, mainly the wheel complex protein, I already told that Mycoplasma genitalium 200, 386, 491 and 219. These four proteins of wheel complex are important for gliding motility. So in study shows that several transient and strong interaction between these four proteins are important for the gliding motility. In that same study, they removed this Mycoplasma genitalium 491 from the cells. So after removing, it showed that some altered pattern of gliding motility are deficient in the gliding motility. This gliding motility is important for the invasion of the organism to the epithelial cells, because this gliding motility, which causes involved in the penetration of organism to the mucosal layer, thereby it will attach to the epithelial cells and it will cause the invasion. Next is the enzymes and toxins. This mycoplasma genitalium, it won't secrete any toxins, but one protein which is mycoplasma genitalium 186, which is called calcium dependent membrane associated nucleus, which degrades the nucleic acids of host cells for their synthesizing the nucleic acid of own own gene. So then coming to the persistence. So persistence is important for avoiding the host immune response. So it is mainly by the process called genetic variation. So as I already told, this two genes that are in Mycoplasma genitalium PB and Mycoplasma genitalium PC. These two genes are encoding this P140 and P11. These are the major adhesins which are involved in the adhesion process. So these are also mostly immunogenic. So against which only this our immune response is produced, mainly antibody response. So if any changes in the expression of this these two genes, so it will leads to it causes the genetic variation. There are two types of variation. One is antigenic variation and next one is the phase variation. So in antigenic variation, this mycoplasma, these two genes are expressed but they produce a sequence, different amino acid sequences. But in phase variation, these two genes are not expressed, thereby this proteins also not expressed, so they lost their capacity to adhere to the epithelial cells. So this is the Mycoplasma genitalium operand, which shows Mycoplasma genitalium PB and Mycoplasma genitalium PC. Only these two are the expression sites, and this Mycoplasma genitalium PAR, as these are the non-expressive sites. So these two are expressive sites, and the Mycoplasma genitalium PAR, which are non-expressive sites. So these expressive sites contains variable region and coding conserved coding regions. So but this my MG PAR regions are containing only variable region. So there is a reciprocal recombination between this variable region. There is a recombination which is acquired between this MG PAR and this expressing genes. If this recombination which is involving only the variable region of this expressive genes, then it causes it will code for some different addition proteins. So that will evade from that is immunologically different from the previously expressed addisons. So that causes the antigenic variation. But if the recombination which involving both variable region and conserved region, so because of there is a recombination of conserved region, the protein synthesis will be deficient. So this B and C genes, it won't express. At the same time, it won't code for that major addition proteins. That's why thereby it will loses its ability of adherence to the epithelial cells. Thereby it's showing the phase variation. So in antigenic variation, there is a sequence is different from the previous addition proteins, but in phase variation it won't code for the addition proteins, thereby it loses the property of adherence to the epithelial cells. So this recombination is tightly regulated process, mainly by the recombinase enzyme, which is coded by RegA, RubA and RubB and RedJ genes. So another one positive regulator, which is MG420ase. This is a positive regulator of this recombination process. This is act as a alternative sigma factor. So sigma factor is a factor which facilitates the attachment of RNA polymerase to the promoter sequence. This is involved in the transcription process. So but there is the environmental factor which stimulate this recombination process is still not known. So what is the importance of this phase variation? So this I already explained, this phase variation, there is no expression of this two genes and there is no production of this major addition proteins. So it won't adhere to the epithelial cells So thereby, it will avoid the clearance by the antibodies and complements. But this, because of loss of expression of these addition proteins, it will detach from the epithelial cells, thereby facilitate the shedding and transmission of this mycoplasma genitalium to the new host or different site in the same host. But this phase variation is reversible by it will get the DNAs from the other mycoplasma genitalium by the horizontal gene transfer mechanism. So it become wild type bacteria, wild type mycoplasma genitalium. So these are the some Indian studies which are showing the prevalence of mycoplasma genitalium. One study which is done by Binhumam and in Ames. So the study population which are selected are MSM population, and the year of study is from 2017 to 2018. The samples which are collected are first voided urine, rectal swab and oropharyngeal swab. That method of detection which is used is PCR targeting this gene, that is MGPA, especially P140 addition. And this prevalence, the total prevalence which is 41.3%, this among this 41.3%, 68.4% of mycoplasma genitalium identified from this anorectum, and from urethra 47.4% are identified. In oropharynx, there is mycoplasma genitalium was not detected from oropharynx. Another study from PGI, Sethi et al, they have selected HIV infected men with NGU symptoms, and this study was done in 2009. The samples are to urethral swab and first voided urine. The method which is used for detection is PCR. The target is same gene, MGPA gene. There they identified mycoplasma genitalium and mycoplasma hominis prevalence is totally 6%, which is common among the HIV positive cases as compared to the HIV negative cases. And what are the modes of transmission? First important mode is the sexual route, among which the vaginal intercourse is having the higher risk, followed by anal intercourse and followed by orogenital mode. And mother to fetus mode is, but this mode is still not an established route of transmission. So what is the interaction between HIV and mycoplasma genitalium? So this mycoplasma genitalium, which is associated with the HIV acquisition and transmission. Here, what are the various mechanisms which increases the HIV acquisition? Are there is a mycoplasma genitalium which stimulate the inflammatory response. So the inflammatory because of this, there is a recruitment of volume of nuclear cells and lymphocyte. So mainly CD4 lymphocyte, which are the cells which are susceptible to the HIV infection, thereby which increase in the HIV susceptibility. And also this mycoplasma genitalium which causes a mucosal disruption. Thereby they are exposing the submucosa directly, the submucosa which contain more of CD4 cells, thereby they increase in the transmission and infection in the host. And also this mycoplasma genitalium which attaches to the HIV infected cells, it causes the protection, increased production and release of the virions, HIV virions. So one study which is showing that the prevalence of HIV infection is infected with, so this prevalence of mycoplasma genitalium is higher in the HIV infected person, that is 49% as compared to the HIV non-infected persons. So here there is a mycoplasma genitalium co-infection with other STIs. This mycoplasma genitalium is usually co-infected with other STD causing organism like Chlamydia trachomatis, Neisseria gonorrhea, Ureaplasma urolyticum and Trichomonas vaginalis. So these are the various studies which are showing that prevalence of this co-infection with mycoplasma genitalium. This study which is showing Neisseria gonorrhea is having 4.1% association, and Chlamydia trachomatis having 21.2% association. Another study which shows Neisseria gonorrhea which is having 38% association, and Chlamydia trachomatis 11% association, and Trichomonas vaginalis 8% of association. Here in this study, Ureaplasma urolyticum shows 1.4% of association with this mycoplasma genitalium. These are the disease associations of Mycoplasma genitalium. It causes non-gonococcal urethritis, cervicitis, but it is not associated with bacterial vaginosis, and it causes endometritis and pelvic inflammatory diseases. It also associated with preterm birth, and because of this pelvic inflammatory diseases, it leads to scarring, so it ultimately leads to the infertility, and it also increases the HIV transmission. Coming to the clinical features in the men. So in men, most commonly it causes non-gonococcal urethritis followed by balanoplastitis. So other extragenital infection which are caused by Mycoplasma genitalium are proctitis and pharyngeal infections. So what are the complications of this Mycoplasma genitalium in men are epididymitis and sexually acquired reactive arthritis. First is a non-gonococcal urethritis. This Mycoplasma genitalium infection is strongly and uniformly associated with non-gonococcal urethritis. The most common organism is Chlamydia trachomatis, which is followed by Mycoplasma genitalium. So in 15-25% of the men with symptomatic NGUs and 5-10% of the men are without symptoms. And more than 75% of the patients are asymptomatic. And the most common symptoms are purulent urethral discharge and dysuria. So this is the prevalence in non-chlamydial, non-gonococcal urethritis patients are 18-45%. So next is the balanoplastitis, that is inflammation of glans penis and inflammation of the prepuce. So only one studies which shows that significant association of this Mycoplasma genitalium with this balanoplastitis, and it is not significantly associated with this chronic prostatitis. Next is the proctitis, which is then one of the important extragenital manifestation of Mycoplasma genitalia. So most common organism which causes proctitis are Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci, which is followed by Mycoplasma genitalia. So in one study they compared that symptoms severity types of clinical features, which is more in Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci as compared to the Mycoplasma genitalium. So symptoms of proctitis which are caused by Mycoplasma genitalium are less severe as compared to Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci. So prevalence are showed in several studies. One study which is done by Francis et al. From 2005 to 2006, which showed prevalence of 12.5%, and other studies which are showing 4.4%. And this study which shows highest prevalence 22%, and the study which is done by Bezazer et al. In MSM group of population, so which shows Mycoplasma genitalium detected in 12% of the anorectal cases, but in the same study which shows the HIV association prevalence of proctitis which is more with HIV patients, that is 21%, as compared to the patient without HIV, that is 8%. So there is a significant association of HIV with proctitis. And also another study which is done by Latimer et al, which shows that also there is a rectal co-infection of Mycoplasma genitalium with Chlamydia trachomatis and Neisseria gonorrhea. So here they are showing a significant association of this Chlamydia trachomatis, that is 13%, and Neisseria gonorrhea, that is 14% of rectal association. Next is the pharyngeal infection or colonization. This is the less common site of extragenital manifestation, but usually it is asymptomatic. But in two studies which are done in Australia, they are showing there is no pharyngeal Mycoplasma genitalium was detected in MSM population. And also in India, one study there is no Mycoplasma genitalium was detected in MSM population. But in study which is done in China, it is showing the highest prevalence of pharyngeal Mycoplasma genitalium, that is significant, 13.5% in the MSM population. So this transmissibility of pharyngeal Mycoplasma genitalium is not known, but it is considered as a passive infection or deposition rather than the active infection. So these two, proctitis and pharyngeal infections, are extragenital manifestations of Mycoplasma genitalium. So only this extragenital screening is only done for Chlamydia trachomatis and Neisseria gonorrhea, which is usually not done for Mycoplasma genitalium. But the extragenital screening is important for this Mycoplasma genitalium. Why? this mycoplasma genitalium, this extra genital sites, the rectal and pharyngeal sites are hidden reservoirs. They are important for the transmission of the pathogen. At the same time, this extra genital screening is only done for Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci. And also this, I already told, this rectal co-infection of this mycoplasma genitalium is significant with these two infections. And also the syndromic management is only aided at treatment of these two infections, that is Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci. So ultimately they will treat this only these two organisms for the extragenital infections mainly with azithromycin 1 gram single dose. So this azithromycin 1 gram, which is a suboptimal dose for the treating the Mycoplasma genitalium, because we are not screening for Mycoplasma genitalium, we will miss the Mycoplasma genitalium infections. So this azithromycin, which is only aided for treatment of this Chlamydia trachomatis and gonococci, so this is a suboptimal dose for this Mycoplasma genitalium, thereby it will select the resistant for the azithromycin. So extragenital screening is essential to prevent the transmission and also for the prevention of this antimicrobial resistance. Next, come to the clinical manifestations in females. Most common manifestation is a cervicitis and followed by the pelvic inflammatory diseases, but it is not associated with the bacterial vaginosis. So this pelvic inflammatory diseases that causing the scarring of this tube ultimately lead to the infertility, and it also causes some adverse effects in pregnancy like preterm delivery, and it also causes a sexually transmitted reactive arthritis. So coming to the indication which are for the laboratory testing. First is the following, if the following signs and symptoms are present, we have this, actually this is a European guidelines 2016, what are the indications for the laboratory testing. First is the symptoms and signs of urethritis in men and mucopurulent cervicitis in women and cervicular vaginal discharge with respect for sexual transmitted infection and intermenstrual or postcoital bleeding and acute pelvic pain with or without pelvic inflammatory diseases and acute epididymorchitis. These are the indications for the testing the Mycoplasma genitalium as per European guidelines 2016. So coming to the laboratory diagnosis, the samples are yearly first voided urine sample, urethral swab, cervical swab and endometrial biopsy, and rectal swab for proctitis, and also we can test oropharyngeal swabs. This swab should be made of calcium alginate, Dacron or the polyester. The swab should be made of either aluminium or plastic. So we should not use wooden swab with the cotton tips, because that have the inhibitory effect on the Mycoplasma genitalium. So these are transport media which is used are SP4 sucrose phosphate medium or the PPLO broth. In our lab, we are usually doing the molecular test like PCR, the targeting the MGPA gene, that is a P140 addition gene. Direct detection is impossible because which is cannot stain by gram stain, because it lack of cell wall and size also 0.5 to 0.6 micrometer. Coming to the treatment, so this susceptibility of this this table which is showing the susceptibility of the Mycoplasma genitalium. So mainly they are susceptible to macrolide antibiotic and quinolones antibiotic, especially the azithromycin and moxifloxacin. So this is the European guidelines in uncomplicated patient. Treatment depends upon the whether patient have complications or not. Complications like epididymitis in men and PID and infertility in women. So this in uncomplicated patients, if macrolide resistant is not there, then we have to use the azithromycin 500 milligram initial dose followed by 250 milligram per day for 4 days. This is the extended regimen. And next, if the macrolide resistant is present, then we should not use the azithromycin. We have to use the moxifloxacin 400 mg OD for 7 to 10 days. But if there is any complications, then we have to use some moxifloxacin same dose, but we have to extend the duration of the treatment for 14 days. So first I will explain the what are the different regimens and resistant mechanisms. First is the macrolide, mostly we are using azithromycin antibiotic. So initially they were used the single dose regimen, that is 1 gram, which is used for the Chlamydia trachomatis and நைசீரியா கொனேரியா. ஸோ திஸ் ஆக்சுவலி திஸ் இஸ் சப் ஆப்டிமல் டோஸ் பிகாஸ் இட் வில் இட் லீட்ஸ் டு செலெக்ஷன் ஆஃப் த ரெசிஸ்டன்ஸ் இன் மைக்கோபிளாஸ்மா ஜெனிடாலியா. ஸோ தட்ஸ் வை இட் இஸ் நாட் ரெக்கமெண்டட். So in various studies from 2005 to 2030, which was showing the initial cure rate was 84% with this single dose regimen, as the year progressed, there is a decreasing in the cure rate to the 40% in 2030. But another regimen, which is extended dose regimen, which is recommended by the European guidelines. So here in this study, which is showing the cure rate for this regimen, 99% and there is no resistance. But if the resistance is already developed for azithromycin, then we cannot use this extended dose regimen. So what is the mechanism of action and mechanism of resistance for macrolides? So mechanism of action is mainly they inhibit the protein synthesis by acting on this 50S ribosome, mainly on the 20S RNA, the residues mainly on the A2058 and A2059 residues of this 23S RNA of this 50S subunit of ribosome. So thereby they inhibit the protein synthesis and also acting on the L4 and L22 residues. These residues are important for stabilization of this ribosome. Thereby, if blocking of this protein, which lead to the loss of stabilization and inhibit the protein synthesis. So what is the mechanism for resistance? Because of it acting on this these residues and these structure, any single nucleotide polymorphism in these two residues or alternation of these two structures, which leads to the resistance. Next, coming to the moxifloxacin, first I will explain the mechanism of action. So mainly this this is a quinolone group of drugs which acting on the inhibition of the DNA synthesis. So it acting on the two enzymes. First is the DNA gyrase, next one is the topoisomerase 4. So in DNA kinase, which is important for initiation of this replication process, because it involves the unwinding of this DNA, thereby it makes the DNA as a single strand for the DNA replication. If it inhibit this DNA kinase, then the unwinding process will not occur, thereby there is no replication process won't occur. And this another enzyme is topoisomerase 4. So this is encoded by PAR-C and PAR-E gene. This DNA kinase is encoded by gyri A and gyri B gene. So in this normal function of this topoisomerase 4 is the separation of this daughter DNA from the parent DNA. So if this enzyme is inhibited, then the daughter DNA won't separate from the parent DNA and there is no elongation of the DNA. So the replication, ultimately the DNA replication process will be inhibited and there is no production of DNAs. So usual dose which is recommended is 400 mg OD for 7 to 10 days. So in one study at 2008, which is showed cure rate of 100%. So how it produces the resistance? Mainly it produces the mutation in QRDR, that is quinolone resistant determining region of this PAR-C and gyri A genes. So the first resistance is reported in Australia, Sydney. At 2008 to 2011, there is a 15% of resistance was reported. So this table, which is showing that various from 2011 to 2018, what are the resistance rates for fluoroquinolones and macrolide? So in this Australia, Sydney, the first moxifloxacin resistance is reported, that is 16% year of 2008 to 2011. So from 2011 to 2018, the macrolide resistance are ranging from 5.3 to 75%, and fluoroquinolone resistance ranging from 2 to 47.1%. The maximum fluoroquinolone resistance is reported at Japan, and maximum macrolide resistance is reported at Ireland, that is 75%. Next, coming to the other drugs, first is the josamycin, which is the macrolide group of drug, which is having same mechanism of action of this as azithromycin, but the site of binding is different. That is A2059G and A2062G, it is different from the azithromycin. So this drug is not available in every part of the world, which is mainly available in Russia, which is used as a first line drug in Russia. The dose is 500 milligram TDS for 10 days. There is no data available on this. And regarding this josamycin, So one study by Alexander et al. Which is showing that cure rate is 93.5% because of this acting binding site is different from this astromycin. If any mutation in this binding sites, they may or may not be susceptible to the astromycin because of this binding site is different from the astromycin. Next, another drug is pristinamycin. This is a streptogramin group of drug which is acting on, which is also acting on the 50S ribosome, thereby inhibiting the protein synthesis. So, which is effective in the macrolide susceptible organism. So, it is a third line drug along with doxycycline. So, the dose is 1 gram 4 times a day for 10 days. In Australia, one study which is showing that all the 6 azithromycin and moxifloxacin resistance cases are cured with this pristinamycin. And another study from 2018 to 2020 which is showing that pristinamycin doxycycline cured with cure rate is only 70%. So from 2012 to 2018 there is a decreasing in the cure rate. Initially it shows 100%, but here it is showing the 70%. So it is indicates some resistance are developing for this pristinamycin. So what is the disadvantage of this pristinamycin is the price is high, and also there is a, some clinical registration of this drug is not there. And other drugs which are used are solithromycin, soliflodacin, spectinomycin and minocycline. So coming to the conclusion, so Mycoplasma genitalium is becoming the infection of increasing concern due to its potential cause of reproductive tract sequelae, that is infertility and pelvic inflammatory diseases. And this causes non-chlamydial, non-gonococcal urethritis from ranging from 18 to 45%. And Mycoplasma genitalium has emerged as a superbug, and a rising resistance in this bacterium is with only a few treatment options are available. And this is it contains various extragenital sites for the hidden reservoir. So the screening of extragenital sites are also important for preventing the transmission and antimicrobial resistance. So future study should look towards the developing newer antimicrobial and proper management guidelines and algorithms. So then monotherapy should not be longer used. Combination therapy should be used for preventing the antimicrobial resistance. And we have to use the etiology based treatment. So because this syndromic management will lead to several antimicrobial resistance. Thank you.
So, Dr. Stephen, I'll ask you the question. There are certain number of the questions. Dr. Rama is asking how type of Mycoplasma pneumoniae is different from this.
Mycoplasma pneumoniae, it contains P1 addition molecule, but here it is P110 and P140 addition molecule, and both tip structures are important for gliding motility and virulence and adherence.
Next question, is there any toxin shown in other Mycoplasma?
Yes, in Mycoplasma pneumoniae, which is showing Cart's toxin, that is community acquired respiratory distress syndrome toxin, and also vacuolating toxins.
How Mycoplasma genitalium increases the transmission of HIV?
Because the CD4 cells are mainly susceptible to the HIV. So the CD4 cells are mainly in the submucosa of the rectum or any vaginal mucosa. So this it causes some ulcerative lesion. It exposes in the submucosa, and also it recruit the polymorph nuclear cells and also CD4 T lymphocyte. Thereby it increases the susceptibility of this CD4 cells to HIV, and also this Mycoplasma genitalium which bind to the
be loud and the slow.
This Mycoplasma genitalium which also binds to the cells which are infected with HIV, thereby they increase in the protection of HIV virions, and also it really increase the release of HIV virions, thereby increasing the transmission and infection of HIV.
Is there any other Mycoplasmas associated with arthritis?
Yes, Mycoplasma pneumoniae which is associated with the reactive arthritis. That is triad of conjunctivitis, arthritis and non-gonococcal urethritis.
What is the NACO guideline for treatment and which we follow for this one? Is there any NECO guidelines?
No, ma'am, there is no guidelines for Mycoplasma genitalium.
Sure.
Yes. But CDC is recommending this drugs like azithromycin and moxifloxacin.
Which carbohydrate is added in the media for its growth?
Glucose is added to the media because it ferments the glucose. Produces the acid, thereby changing the color of medium from pink to yellow.
What are the other superbugs? As you said, this is a Mycoplasma genitalium superbug. What do you understand by the superbug?
Superbug means which is increasing the resistance to the most of the antibiotics.
So
it is initially resistant to azithromycin followed by moxifloxacin and other drugs like josamycin, pristinamycin, and it shows the resistant to the most of the available antibiotics which are used for the treatment of Mycoplasma genitalium.
So what do you think, what can be the other superbugs apart from this Mycoplasma genitalium?
Klebsiella pneumoniae, also one of the superbug because it is showing hypervirulent property and also which is showing resistant to the carbapenem antibiotics and also colistin antibiotics.
What else? There are so many superbugs.
Salmonella, Neisseria, gonorrhea, and they are also showing the antibiotics to the available resistant to the available antibiotics. And tuberculosis also showing.
Okay, what about the population structure of Mycoplasma genitalium? Population structure of Mycoplasma genitalium.
Mycoplasma genitalium is mostly prevalence is more in HIV population and also in MSM population. And those who are having more sexual partners and population which is having sexually active adult with more sexual partners.
Can we artificially synthesize Mycoplasma?
I don't know.
You don't know? Dr. Rama is saying arthritis, answer is wrong. Are you sure about Mycoplasma pneumonia is causing the arthritis?
Yes, ma'am. Mycoplasma pneumonia is having various extra pulmonary manifestations. Arthritis also one of the extra pulmonary manifestation.
Superbugs as per WHO and CDC guideline. CDC complete the list of superbugs and mail it.
Okay.
And Mycoplasma genitalium, Dr. Mehta is saying, is in fact not an opportunist as far as HIV is concerned. Suggesting. Population structure is sequence types, not the population involved. We are asking the population structure of Mycoplasma genitalium. We are not asking which population is infected with the Mycoplasma genitalium. It is about the sequence types of Mycoplasma genitalium.
Strains.
Yeah. Sequence types, strains, whatever you know.
Strains, initially there is two strains, ma'am. G37 and M30, two strains.
Be loud and clear and show it.
So initially identified strains are G37 and M30 strains.
Only these are the sequences? Only these are the sequence types?
I will check and...
Yeah, you will check and complete the list. Dr. Rosalind is asking under syndromic management of STD, it is treated with TAF azithromycin single dose. I think you have covered it part. Can
yes,
you explain it again?
For urethral discharge or any rectal discharge, it is treated with azithromycin 1 gram single dose and cefixin 400 mg. At a gray color kit.
Which is the most common cause of non-gonococcal urethritis?
Chlamydia trachomatis. It is ranging from 30 to 50%.
Dr. Ashish Chaudhary is suggesting lab diagnosis has to be elaborated in a bit detail. You have only explained, and he is also suggesting you can put the video of the gliding mortality. Okay,
I will see.
Can you just brief the lab diagnosis in your point of view?
Actually, samples are collected, are first voided urine sample, urethral swabs, and urethral swab, cervical, endocervical swab, or endometrial biopsy. In case of extragenital samples, are rectal swab and oropharyngeal swab, which are should be streaked at the place of sample collection, or it should be immediately transported to the lab with the transport medium or SP4 medium. So this the swab should be used, or Dacron swab, or tip of the swab should be made of Dacron or alginate, and swab should be made of aluminium or plastic. So it should not be made of wooden shaft with the cotton tip, because it is having inhibitory effect on the mycoplasma genitalium. So if the any delay in the transport, we can store it at refrigerator for 24 hours. Then if it is we want beyond that limit, then we have to store at minus 80 degree Celsius. We should not store it at minus 20 degree Celsius, because it's sensitive to minus 20 degree. Then after that, here we are most commonly doing PCR, which is targeting the MGPA gene. Then we cannot do the direct detection. We cannot do, because it is not stained by Gram stains, but we can do by acridine orange or any DNA fluorochrome stains. And culture also, it will take long time. The generation time is ranging from 16 to 18 hours. So it will take 1 month to 50 days for growing. So it is also not usually done in our lab. We are doing PCR for its identification.
Okay, what is the most motile mycoplasma? Which is the most motile mycoplasma?
Mycoplasma mobile.
Mycoplasma?
Mobile.
Mobile. Sure.
Yes, ma'am.
Rama ma'am is saying artificial mycoplasma mycoides made in Venter Lab, USA. Okay. Artificial mycoplasma mycoides made in Venter Lab, USA. And arthritis by ureaplasma, what you were describing? The
mycoplasma pneumoniae.
Ureaplasma. Arthritis by ureaplasma. Is there any cases?
My will check.
Okay. There are some more questions that I'll make up. Well done, Stephen. Everyone is saying thank you.
Thank you, ma'am.
This week you will add all the questions which you have not answered in the presentation and mail it to everyone. Okay. Thank you so much.
Thank you.